What miracle were they looking for? They saw dangerous dimensions of God. But at the slightest opportunity, they bowed to Baal. They committed adultery with Ashtaroth.
Okay, my minister. So there's a need to what? Continue. So the promise of holiness, the promise of being blameless, the promise of not having reproach in his sight is not an open promise. There's a condition. If you indeed do what? Continue where? In the faith. So the matter is the faith. So by the time we read through scriptures, we don't have that time, and we begin to do definition of terms. You will find out that what faith is, faith is. Faith is the firm belief. Firm belief, trust, and loyalty to Jesus Christ. Belief in, trust in, and loyalty to Jesus Christ. That's what faith is. So there's a dimension of faith that is belief. So you believe in Jesus. In believing in Jesus, there's what we call the body of beliefs. There's something that characterizes the Christian faith. And all of those things spawn out of our first believing in Jesus. Then there's a dimension of faith that is trust, absolute confidence and dependency in Christ. And then there's a dimension of faith that is loyalty. So when Paul says, if indeed you continue in your belief in Christ, your trust in Christ, and your loyalty to Christ, grounded and steadfast. The word grounded and steadfast can be collapsed into one word: being faithful. To be faithful is to sustain the character of being steadfast and loyal. Are you still with me? Go back to 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 18. Let me show you something. 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 18. This charge I commit to you, son Timothy, according to the prophecies previously made concerning you, that by them you may wage the good warfare. Verse 19. Having what?
Faith.
Having faith and a good conscience, which some have rejected concerning what? The faith. So, having faith will be absolute trust. Are you with me? Which some have rejected concerning the faith. Will be now belief in Jesus. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
The faith speaks about our belief in Christ. So the Bible will say, contending for what? Which was what? Unto you. The faith. That is our belief, our body of convictions as relates to our Christian reality on account of the salvific work of Jesus Christ. But he says, having faith and a good conscience, which some, having rejected concerning the faith, have suffered what? Shipwreck. Next verse. Of whom are what? Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I deliver to Satan, that they may learn not to what?
Blaspheme.
Praise God. So, how is it that you are able to shipwreck your faith? Paul says it's a good warfare. Where does the warfare occur? I want to start teaching now. Are you still with me?
Yes, sir.
Where does the warfare occur? You see, as I engaged God and I prayed, the Lord gave me three arenas of battle. Number one, poverty. Number two, pleasure. Number three, pain. Number one, what did I call it? Poverty. Number two, what? Number three, what? Pain. See, brethren, if you can win your battles in these three areas, if you can win your battles in these three areas, you will not shipwreck your faith. Notice in 1 Timothy, he says, you have having faith and what? A good conscience. Which some people wandered away from. What did they wander from? The good conscience. Okay, let's put it in NLT. Help me. Give me NLT from verse 18. NLT. You will see how simple it is. NLT in verse 18. From verse 18. Timothy, my son, here are my instructions to you. Based on the prophetic word spoken about you earlier, may they help you fight well where? In the Lord's battles. Next verse. Cling to your faith in Christ and keep your conscience clear, for some people have deliberately done what? Violated their consciences. How did they do it? Deliberately. And because they have violated their consciences, as a result, their faith has been what? Shipwrecked. So how do they deliberately violate their consciences? It's either in the area that relates to the matters of poverty, or the areas that relate to the matters of pleasure, or the areas that relate to the matters of pain. Shall you know that there are people now who are glorifying Yahoo, internet fraud. Are you aware?
Yes, sir.
And the way they are glorifying it is that they are saying, no blame the boy. After all, if they use them, they take care of his family. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So he's taking care of his family with stolen money. In fact, I've had a case here where a sister, I think it's a sister, and I can't remember, came to me and said, she knows that her brother is using Yahoo money to take care of the family. And I said, if you didn't know, it's a different thing. Now that you know, eating from that money, you are an accomplice. If you eat, you are deliberately doing what? Violating what? Your conscience. And what will happen is that you will shipwreck your faith. You see, brethren, tonight, in this poverty matter, I want to deal with some certain things, and I want us to go through the scriptures. You see, because there are many of you that have lost your trust in Jesus. You are willing to sell your loyalty to him, and your belief in him is shaking because you don't have money. And we can't blame you. There are all kinds of sayings that are being pushed around the body of Christ. For instance, without doing it intentionally, in the body of Christ, we have seemed to give the impression that a rich Christian is more useful to God than a poor one. A rich Christian is more useful to the kingdom than a poor one. So somebody says things like, I will be a better Christian if I am rich. Are you with me?
Yes,
I will be a better believer. If I have money, I'll be a better believer. Listen, on the path of spiritual progress, understand this. On the path of spiritual progress, there are two dimensions that will characterize the Christian's advance. One, there is your spiritual life. Two, there is your spiritual witness. What did I call it? And spiritual what? Witness. So there is your living and there is your witness. As you advance on the path of spiritual progress, you are supposed to be deepening your spiritual life and strengthening your spiritual witness. Your spiritual life has to do with your relationship with the Lord. Are you here?
Yes, sir.
Stay with me, because I know that this thing is going to get me into trouble, but I have settled with Jesus. In your spiritual life, you are supposed to be deepening your spiritual life. And what that has to do with is your relationship with the Lord. When somebody says, I will be a better Christian if I have money, he's speaking about either his spiritual life or his spiritual witness. And he's saying that my relationship with God will be deeper if I have more money. And my witness unto God will be stronger if I have money. So invariably, alternately, we are saying that a poor Christian cannot have a deep relationship with God. And a poor Christian cannot have a strong witness of Christ. What is witnessing? Witnessing is just representing Christ to the world. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
How does money affect these two things, if you are honest? How? Does it mean that if you have more money, your prayer life will be improved? Does it mean that if you have more money, your love for God will be improved? Does it mean that if you don't have money, you cannot bear witness to the resurrection of Jesus Christ? And you see, I'm willing to be put on the stake and killed if I am found to be wrong. I'm willing. But you see, brethren, I have studied Jesus once, twice, three times, a little more times. I've tried to read Jesus. Nobody followed Jesus and became a millionaire. None. None. There was no testimony in the Bible that it was the result of Jesus' teaching that brought men into prosperity. None. Listen, don't hear what I'm not saying. I'm not saying it is wrong for a Christian to be rich. I'm not saying that riches are evil. I'm quoting Jesus, and I will show you Jesus. Why? The matters of your spiritual life in the Bible tells you that riches are a snare. So when somebody is growing on the path of spiritual progress, and their primary desire is that I want to be rich. Paul says that if you have those kind of desires, you will pierce yourself with many sorrows. We will see that scripture shortly. So the Bible counsels that such desires should not be found in the heart of a pilgrim. So when you are thinking that the proof of your love for God is in the size of your bank account, Satan has already won you in the arena of poverty. Many young people, the reason your Christian life is not working is that money has choked your faith. The desire for money. You don't know how long I've wept before God. I know the implications of what I'm saying. I know what I'm saying. Now, there are people that are going to come out now and say, and he's trying to build a place that is going to cost 900 million. And see what he's teaching. Hear me, I've told you before, if God cannot send money to build the place, it will remain unbuilt. But the truth of the Bible will not be compromised on my tongue. God forbid. Do you know that I have found out that the people that give the most to the work of God are the people that don't really have. I know. A lady reached me from Turkey after a Bible study. And in the messages she sent to me, she was weeping. She said, I don't have a job. But when I heard you teach, God said, I should give everything I have to Arose and Warri. But you don't have work. She said, immediately I find a job. The minute I'm paid, I'm sending it. She got a job. They paid her $310. She sent everything to the last kobo to the account for the project. To the last kobo. The people who give the most are not necessarily the people that have so much. I have a brother in Canada. He supports us in this ministry to the best of his ability. He was telling me one day, he said, I don't have savings. The minute he finishes working, he's like a channel. God says, send money there. He can send 1 million here, send 1 million there, and he doesn't have anything left. Nothing in his savings. The people who sacrifice the most for God are the people that really don't have more than enough. They just have enough to take care of themselves and their families, but they've traveled so far into God that Satan can't use money to cripple their relationship with Jesus. Right now, Christians are envying thieves. Do you know, dear brother, that this is why in the church of Jesus Christ today, you will know that a politician killed, maimed, rigged his way to power. Our pastors will give them opportunity to do thanksgiving in church. Why? With the thanksgiving, it's not the thanksgiving that is the matter. With the thanksgiving, omeno kovinai. May the Lord give you understanding. So somebody that sings about breasts and nakedness and all kinds of immorality, he will also be giving mic to do thanksgiving in church. And you know what he's saying to the church? What the pastor is saying to the church is, all you young people here that are following God, you don't know how to make money. That you can come, you can sing for Satan and then come and give thanks to a holy God. So people's faith are being shipwrecked because they are losing the war of poverty. Let me quote Jesus now. Or let me quote Paul first. Give me 1 Timothy chapter 6. Begin at verse 1. If you are still with me, say amen.
Amen.
1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 1. Let as many bond servants as are under the yoke count their own masters worthy of all honor, so that the name of God and his doctrine may not be blasphemed. Verse 2. And those who are believing masters, let them not despise them because they are brethren, but rather serve them because those who are benefited are believers and beloved. Teach and exhort these things. Verse 3. If anyone teaches otherwise and does not consent to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which accords with what? Godliness. He is proud, knowing nothing, but is obsessed with disputes and arguments over words, from which come envy, strife, rivaling, evil suspicions, useless wranglings of men of corrupt minds, and destitute of the truth, who suppose that godliness is a means of what? From such, what do you do? Withdraw yourself. Next verse. Now, godliness with what? Is what? Media, stay with me. Leave that verse there. Godliness with what? You see, in the arena of poverty, the war is for your contentment. That's the matter. At every state you are in life, are you contented? Or there is an ambition that continues to burn within your soul? An ambition. A lust. You know why? Because even within the Christian space, what we call success is a lie. We use the world's definition of success to define the success of a man's life. Oh my God, I won't have time to read it, so let me tell you. You remember in the book of Luke, a man came to meet Jesus. He said, tell my brother to share the inheritance with me. Do you remember that story? And Jesus, you see, when I read Jesus, I can joke with other things in the scripture, and I don't mean that literally. I'm just being metamorphorical. Whether it's correct or not, I will know at home. Now, Jesus looked at a man. A man came there and said, tell my brother, it's my share. It's my share. My father's inheritance is supposed to be shared for two of us. Jesus, instead of addressing the matter, looked at the man and said, there's something wrong with you. He said, beware of what? covetousness. Oga, Baba J, they brought matter of injustice to you. Somebody is trying to trample on my rights. Somebody is treating me badly. You leave the matter of injustice and then you go to matter of covetousness. And then Jesus takes that opportunity to teach something critical. He says, a man's life does not consist of the things that he what? So that means the way heaven measures men has nothing to do with what the man has. God looks beyond what you drive. He looks beyond what you wear. He looks beyond what is in your bank account to determine your worth. While the earth measures men's worth by their... They taught you in Urobo, taught some of you in Yoruba. You went to school and graduated with a 2-1. But you're under pressure. Everybody in your compound is putting their children in Tiny Tots International. British Montessori. Le Buravaca. Now you can't sleep in the night. We used to live on Jakpa Road. We now moved to Otokutu. We removed our daughters from the school because that time, Foel was 167. We removed them and brought them closer. Because by the time you drive there, drive back, you can't sustain it. Many of you, your faith is shipwrecked. You're under pressure because you don't want to be poor. You don't want anybody to laugh at you. So Satan has given you an assignment that God didn't send you. Godliness with contentment. What is the gain? What is the gain here? Great gain. Your faith will not be shipwrecked. You will make it to the finish line. Satan cannot hold something over your neck. You say the reason she's sleeping around is because her mother cannot pay her school fees. Drop out. Drop out. Go and defer your admission and go and fry akara. With your pointed nose, sit in front of frying pan. Fry akara and raise your school fees. And go back to school with honor and with pride. But poverty. That's why some churches now, the whole administration and the whole thing about the church is running on Yahoo money. Yahoo money. Thieves are funding the work of God. Thieves. Because we are losing the war. Everybody is afraid of poverty. We don't want the world to see us like we are failing. You know, I grew up in church and I used to wonder, how did we reach the conclusion in Genesis chapter 2 that the four rivers that are watering the Garden of Eden have to do with resources? I grew up in church hearing preachers say you should have a minimum of 4 sources of income. That there were 4 rivers watering Eden. They use it in motivational preachings, use it every, and then you will leave the meeting. You've not even been able to sustain one. They say if you don't have 4, you are finished. So the average young man is under pressure. His faith, his belief, his trust, and his loyalty is now at stake. So the average young person can do anything for money. See, brethren, the recommendation of the Bible is hard work. Will all of us be rich? Nobody knows. Whether I'll be rich and you'll be richer than me, nobody knows. That is within the purview of God's sovereignty. God's sovereignty. God's sovereignty. The way the Christian life is designed is that those that have are supposed to take care of those that don't have. That's the design. They say they that had lands sold it and brought it to the apostles' feet. Such that there was none amongst them that lacked. None. The Bible says none that lacked. None that lacked. That's the principle me I'm operating on. That's why I will come here and tell you about the building. And those that have been blessed by God to that level will now make sacrifice. And then we are giving. We are giving. Little by little, the place is getting built. Little by little, the place is getting built. On the backs of people who have determined that my resources belong to Jesus. But to have an ambition that the only way you'll be able to prove your witness to the world is in the abundance of riches. Satan has sifted you. Sifted you. That's why there are girls now, Christian girls, that are ashamed of what they have become. They've sold their body for money. There are people sitting here now. Compromise has finished your life. Because if you don't win the war of resources, if you don't come to this place where you are contented, in that place of poverty, what Satan wants you to do is that he wants you to compromise. There are three things he's trying to achieve. He wants to achieve compromise, he wants to achieve worship, and then he wants to steal your devotion. So there are many who are depressed because they don't have money. Many who are planning now that if they get an opportunity to do something against God, they will do it. Brethren, don't believe me. Just go and read the news. Just do a little research yourself and find out. Pastors, so-called pastors in this country have been arrested for organizing Ponzi schemes. Pastors are manipulating markets, financial markets. Pastors are engaging in all kinds of things, whether it is shares, whether it's stocks, whether it's crypto. They are doing all kinds of things underground just to make money. And when they've made the money, they still come back and stand to represent Jesus. You see, brethren, I fear for the end of the age. Because you see, the pastor will think now that he has gotten away with it. He has manipulated things and become rich over people's blood. But there's a judge of the whole earth. And one day, every man will give account of the things he has done. Every man. So in the arena of finances, of poverty, Satan is after you compromising. He's after you worshipping money. And then he's after your devotion. He wants to cripple your devotion. Let's finish the scripture. Go to verse 7. For we brought nothing where? And it is certain that what? Next verse. And having food and clothing, with these we shall be what? Content. Having food and clothing. If the presence of luxury or the absence of luxury can affect your spiritual life and your spiritual witness, your Christianity is fake. What I'm saying is, if riches are what you are waiting for to make you a better Christian, or if poverty is what has not allowed you to become a better Christian, your Christianity is a fraud. You are fake. Money does not affect our love for God. The absence of money does not affect our love for God. We pray in season and out of season. We commit our lives to Jesus, whether we have or we don't have. We are willing to die for truth and live righteously with integrity, with holiness, whether there is plenty or there is nothing. If we have food, bro, and we have clothing, we should be contented. The reason many Christians are suffering now, they want to build a 50 billion naira mansion. It's a lust that is existing within their hearts. You see me? And I'm just teaching. I've checked, and the Holy Spirit has given me liberty, so I will share. You see, I'm just teaching. If I had that 750 million to build that facility, you will not hear me announce it. God has dealt with me to that level that if he puts that money in my hand, I will not announce to you. I will go there, build it. All of us will move there. We continue worshiping. When we are about to start RCN Warri, my cooperative where I work advertised some places for people to stay. So I went and I took one so that it can be taken from my salary on an annual basis. And then as I was taking it, I said, how am I going to build it? So I took some money too that I will start the building. Then the burden of RCN Warri came. That place we are sitting in, those of you that have been to that venue, when we entered inside, it was like a shrine. By the time we started work, we paid 1.something million for the place. All the money I had that I said I want to use to build my own house, to start building my house, God said, put it there. Then we started working. We started working. If I have not, I'm not telling you now, you will never know. Never know. I have learned long ago, giving to God is a privilege. God doesn't need our money. It's a privilege. You don't know that as we are seated here now, God can raise somebody somewhere and say, go and give $300,000 to that project. And you don't know, the person gives, you never hear the person's name. That's how potent God is. So if God now gives us the privilege that we are contributing, let me show you a scripture. Remind me, which verse are we? Give me Luke 17 and verse 10. Luke 17 verse 10. Okay, begin at verse 8. 8. 7. And which of you, having a servant, plowing or tending sheep, will say to him, when he has come in from the field, come at once, sit down to eat. Do you understand what is happening here? You are the master of the house. And then you come back in the evening. And then you also have a servant who takes care of your sheep in the field. He says, which of you, when you come back, will tell your servant, leave all you are doing and come and eat. Next verse. But will he not rather say to him, prepare something for my supper, and gird yourself and serve me till I have eaten and drunk, and afterward you will eat and drink? Is this not what everybody will do? Will you not tell your servant, both of you came back, oh? Some of us, we do it to our wives. Sure, you are hearing the wives now. Both of you came back the same time. And our guy is on the bed, cross his leg, he's on laptop. Where my food, oh? But not be me and you come back just now. Talk less of servant. He said, will you not, this is Jesus speaking, oh, not me, Jesus. He said, will you not tell him, go and prepare my food. Serve me. And then when I have eaten, you now go and eat. That's what Jesus was saying. Next verse. Does he thank that servant because he did the things that were commanded him? Jesus said, what? I think not. He doesn't thank the servant for doing his job. Is his job. Next verse. So likewise, you, when you have done all those things which you are commanded, say, we are unprofitable servants. We have done what was our duty. This is Jesus. When you have done the things God commanded you to do, Jesus said, this is the way you should address yourself. I am an unprofitable servant. I have only done my what? My duty. Giving is a privilege. If you have it to give and God is saying, give it, and you refuse to give it, it's only time he will raise somebody else that will obey him. It's just time. We are not controlled or governed by the lust for wealth. No. Go back to 1 Timothy. I think we're in verse 8. 6:8. 6:8. Let me dive now. Let me run. I have to run quickly now. 6:8. 1 Timothy 6:8. 9. 9. But those who desire to be what? Fall into temptation and a snare, and into many and harmful lusts, which drown men in what? Destruction and perdition. This is how they shipwreck their faith. Those who desire, when they have made it an obsession, I must be rich, I must be rich, I must be rich. It is God that makes men rich. It is his sovereign prerogative to make men rich. If you decide that you cannot wait for God to fulfill his own side of the bargain, that's when compromise will begin to eat at your soul. Eat at your soul. While I was praying this afternoon, I saw a quick vision. And God told me that that person will be in this service. Whether the person is on site or the person is online, I saw a quick vision. I saw the person falsifying documents. I saw a quick vision. Falsifying documents, and the pressure is hunger. And I heard God, he said, if you admit tonight, I will show you mercy. I heard God. The second thing I saw was a young man kissing a married woman. I saw it. And God told me that that brother will be in this meeting. On site or online. I saw him kissing a married woman. Because the second dimension of this offer is pleasure. And while the war in poverty is for compromise, for worship, and for devotion, the war in pleasure is for the potency of your priesthood. Satan wants to make you unclean so that you will be a useless priest. You will still wear the garment of priesthood, but you can't wield the authority of Jesus. The driver is uncleanliness. He wants you dressed like a priest. When we see you, you are dressed like a priest. But when you are put on a scale in the spirit, there's a shout. You know, in those days, when lepers in the Old Testament, when they walked around, they had to walk around with a bell. And they will be shouting, the unclean one cometh. The unclean one cometh. So that people will not accidentally touch him. And they themselves will become clean. Unclean. So he needed to announce, I'm unclean. I'm unclean, oh, I'm unclean. One that has begun to engage in the pleasures of sexual immorality is Satan that is announcing your reality in the spirit. An unclean man cometh. So in the realm of the spirit, demons can identify you, even angels can identify you, and truly spiritual men can identify you. You don't know immorality has a stench. It has a stench. It has killed many young people. Ask them, why are you living like this? Say, my parents are suffering. So it is what is in Satan's hand that you want to use to create a problem, to solve a problem Satan created. You're a joker. A house divided against itself before. You can't use Satan to fight Satan. You must find a scepter of righteousness. You must come to a place where you don't have a price. Bro, if you had told Judas when he started that he will sell Jesus for 30 pieces of silver, he would not have agreed. But one day he woke up and went to the chief priest and he said, how much will you give me if I hand him over to you? What have you handed over to the devil? Because of lack. You don't know how to be content. Listen, brethren, you will not be broke forever. Are you hearing me? You will not be broke forever. A day will come when you will move beyond that level. The reason you are not even measuring your life correctly is that you don't even recognize that God has been blessing you because you have oju kokoro. That's what they call it in Yoruba. Your eye is big. You are looking for. So even the little blessings that God has given to you, you don't recognize it. Were you like this before? Is this where you started your life? You are wearing glasses now, looking like a fine man. Now, so you be before. And you cannot acknowledge God who picked you up. David said, he took me from the miry clay and he set my feet. Omanakade. This obsession with money wants to cripple a generation. And I'm saying to you, there's not much you can do with your prophecy if you have lost the war over poverty. There's not much. It doesn't matter how glorious the prophecy is. If money has become your God, the God of the whole earth no longer has room to fight your cause. He no longer has room. He says the root of all kinds of evil, for which some have done what? Strayed. How? In their greediness, they don't have contentment. Greed is a yearning for something you cannot have and the willingness to do anything to get it. Greed. And he says, what happened? They pierce themselves through with what? Many sorrows. Next verse. But you, who is he speaking to now? The man of God. You see, when I teach, I don't care what sons of Belial will say. I don't have their time. I don't have their time. I came to speak to men and women of God. Those that are on the path of spiritual progress, who are telling themselves that if God can be found, I will find him before I die. I will travel into the belly of God. I will know God like I know my name. I will touch him. It's those people I came to talk to. He said, oh man of God, you flee these things. Flee. And pursue what? Righteousness, godliness, faith, love, and what? Patience, and what? Gentleness. Verse 12. Do what? So he's now telling you the whole matter. It's a fight. If you are going to pursue righteousness, if you are going to pursue love, if you are going to pursue gentleness, it's a fight. You have an enemy in the ring and he does not play nice. He said, lay hold unto eternal life, to which you were also called and have confessed the good confession in the presence of who? Let me show you Jesus. Give me Luke chapter 8. Give me verse 10. Luke chapter 8. We don't have time now. Luke chapter 8 verse 10. We don't have time. Remember, this parable is called in the Bible the parable of what? The sower. How many of you have seen that parable before? A sower went out to sow seed. Some fell by the wayside. Some fell up among stones up here on the mountain. Some fell among thorns. And then when he had finished telling the parable, the disciples met him later and said, ah, Oga, we don't understand. We say, oh, you too, you do not know. So he began to say, and he said, to you it has been given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, but to the rest it is given in parables, that seeing they may not see, and hearing they may not understand. 11. Now the parable is this. 1. The seed is what? The word of God. Number 2. Those by the wayside are the ones who hear, then the devil comes and takes away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and... Next verse. But the ones on the rock are those who, when they hear, receive the word with joy, and these have no root, who believe in a while, and in the day of what? Temptation. What happens? Look at the next group. Now, the ones that fell among tongues are those who, when they have heard, go out and are choked with what? What's the next thing there? Riches. And the pleasures of life, and bring what? No fruit to maturity. It chokes your faith. So when I came up with those three things, there are not things I carved from my mind. Poverty, riches, pleasures, sexual immorality, entertainment, and all kinds of things. The cares of this world, pain. You say they bring no fruit. It chokes. We don't have time to read Luke 18. But when you get home, go and read verse 24. Jesus said, how hard it is. How hard it is for the rich to enter into the kingdom of God. Then the disciples said, so who therefore will be saved? He said, with men is impossible, but with God. Except that rich man is a man who is under the government of God. It's hard. He says, how hard it is for them that have riches, that have it. Don't hear what I'm not saying. I've not told you that money is bad. Look at us trying to do conference now. God had to go and speak to somebody to send us money to support, because we don't want to announce, because we're already announcing for building. We say we'll use money that we are saving for the Warri City Crusade. That's where we are scooping from to use, because that our major meeting cost us tens of millions. But we say we'll not announce. We can't put pressure on the people. Let God take care of his work. We use money to do things, but we will not be slaves of money. We won't. If you are a thief, we will tell you you are a thief. We are not afraid of your face. You are a thief. We are not afraid of your face. And in the day we find out that you have begun to live a life that is not in relation to the kind of things we teach, we will call you out. We are sick and tired of church people sitting in services, but they are not transformed. We are tired. Their spiritual life is not deepened. Their spiritual witness is not strong. All because everybody is in a hurry to overcome poverty. Oga, God is able to bless the work of your hands. Many will be rich. Some will just be comfortable in this life. Some may never be rich till they die. Godliness with contentment is great gain. If Satan cannot defeat you in the arena of poverty, he will come to the arena of pleasure. The desire for sex, the desire for entertainment, he will begin to fight you there. And the whole idea is that he wants to choke your faith. I'm out of time now. He wants to choke your faith. He wants to kill what it is that you carry. He wants to make sure that you are unclean. Like I told you, nothing corrupts a man's glory like sexual immorality. It's a killer. And the battle with sexual immorality is that it wants to weaken the potency of your priesthood. Brethren, we are at war. You see this territory where we are? It's the valley of the shadow of death. Only strong men can survive here. Only strong men. I was speaking to a young brother, and he said another young brother who had been following me for a while gave him counsel when he was coming into the city. When he came into the city, the young brother told him, he said, say, this place, just go and hide yourself in a congregation where they understand what the dynamics in the spirit. He said, because this place, if you are not hidden in a place that is pure, they will finish you. He said, because here, there's a predominant spirit. It's called sexual immorality. If you are not aware, if you've been attending our schools of the spirit, our training in prayer, you would have heard me say it many times. There are three predominant spirits in our city. It's sexual immorality, it is violence, it is the spirit of religion. These are the things we deal with. The religious spirit. And the one that is more potent is sexual immorality. You know why? Because we are surrounded by river. We are the river, we are the south. There's water around us. And the predominant spirit, when you see water, is a water spirit, is a marine spirit. The expression of the marine spirit is lasciviousness, is immorality, is all kinds of perversion. When you see the serpentine spirit, what it signifies is witchcraft, divination, and sorcery. But when you see the marine spirit, is immorality. That's why when you go to a shop right in the evening, you will see 14, 15 year olds dressing like prostitutes. They are looking for man at 15. You think that is a desire for sex? That is a spirit. The brother that was telling me, by the time he finished telling me the story, there were tears in his eyes. He said, I did not listen. When the spirit came after him, it crippled him. Satan wants to make you so weak that when you stand in the arena of warfare, you even want to fight on behalf of your family. You say you don't have a voice. The priests that labor in that realm for God must be priests that are holy unto the Lord. The thing that makes the scepter in your hand potent is that you have been separated unto God. Unto God. So when Satan comes to tempt you with a sister's breast, he is not after your today. He wants your priesthood to be flat. Pornography is not entertainment. It's the war for priesthood. That's why you are still masturbating. No matter how hard you try, Satan wants you to be crippled in the spirit. So there are a lot of people who are wearing priestly garments. They are crippled in the spirit. They can't stand. They can't wage the Lord's war. Paul said that you might be able to fight the Lord's battles. If you lose in the arena of pleasure, you will now begin to lose in the arena of pain. Pain. And when we are speaking about pain, we are talking about both physical and emotional. We are talking about matters of health. Many people have lost their faith, shipwrecked their faith, drifted from the faith, strayed away from the faith because they think that God cannot heal their body. They've waited for God, and they have decided that, oh, this God is taking too long. So out of the pain of what they call abandonment, they have begun to look to Ezemos, look to native doctors and witches to solve their health problems. You see, brethren, if you will be a better Christian because you are healed and healthy, your Christianity is fraud. And I'm not talking about, when we talk about Christianity, we're not talking about church attendance. We're not talking about how much you are contributing to projects. We are talking about how much you are looking like Christ. If you need money to look like Christ, you are a fraudster. Go and do Yahoo. Let's know that you are into Yahoo. You are not a Christian. To look like Christ, whether you are in plenty or you are in nothing, your life should mirror his reality on a daily basis. Whether you are sick or you are healthy, our God does miracles. Ask Joshua. It was in Benin just now. A lady came out with her glasses. Where was that place that lumps were flying? It even went from a lady's private part. Where was that? Four square. Okay, you were following. Lumps were just flying out. I have seen miracles, and I still know that no man has the prerogative to heal any man. Healing is the sovereign agenda of Jesus. So what does the Christian do? When you come out for a prayer this week and you don't get healed, you go back and say, I know my Redeemer liveth. Let Satan come and say, where is the God that say he will heal you? My God is the same yesterday. He's the same today. He's the same forever. If he did it before, he will do it again. That thing that he did in the Old Testament, he can do it in the new. If he did it in the new, he can do it in my day. I'm not afraid. If you allow Satan to begin to steal your joy because of pain, you will shipwreck your faith. One day I had to comfort my wife. Tears were falling from her eyes. She said, why are people like this? Because if Satan can't touch your body, he will use people that you love and you are willing to die for to pierce your heart. They will wound you. You'll be in pain. You'll be wondering what you did wrong. All you did was open your heart to love somebody, and they took advantage of love to betray you with a kiss. I had to comfort my wife. I said, and so people they do. And so they do. You have to move beyond your pain. Do you know what people are going through? I was reading of a young man. He's the breadwinner of his family. His mother is a widow. His two other brothers are blind. He is the breadwinner. He died in an accident. The only person in the family. How do you go and tell those people God love you? If those people have not deepened their spirit life, they will think that God is wicked. And once Satan, in the war of pain, the war Satan is fighting is for your confidence, your trust in God. If Satan can get you to see God different from what he is, he can finish you. A young lady came from abroad 4-5 years ago to come and marry. That time they still used to do all these phone calls in public places. I don't know what they call it again. It has phased out. Eh? Business center. And she sat down there with her fiancé. They were to get married the very next week. She sat down there with her fiancé making call. A reckless driver ran into them and killed the man on the spot. She came to marry. A sister that was a mama in fellowship followed her people that they are going to for wedding. Her own wedding was the next week. She was going to her fellow sister's wedding. They had accident. Everybody came out. Only her died. We were here. We finished service. And that day as we were in service, we were singing, "No glory in this world. No great name here." We had just come back from a ministration in Delta State University. God had moved with power. My son was on the drums, playing drums the way he normally plays, with his eyes closed, his spirit alive. They went to return equipment. They crossed the road to go and buy bread and suya. He was the only one sitting there on the car. Brother Mudiaga was in the other place. And a reckless Yahoo boy came, drove into them, crushed his two legs. By the time we rushed him to the hospital, 4 a.m. in the morning, he had died. In your pain, if you don't know how to sing the songs of Zion, you will shipwreck your faith. I want to show you 3 scriptures from Job. And then we close.
Oh Lord, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. Oh Lord, you are, I will ever.